You ever been on the business end of a gun? I think you know the end I mean. Not the trigger. The end where the bullets come out. I was on the end of that gun one time. That's a really funky, surreal, you can't believe it's happening kind of feeling. Because you look down that cold, steely barrel and you know it's at the other end. And it ain't good. One night after hours, I was at a club that I used to hang around with, and I knew all the staff that worked there. So we were going to go out and get a few drinks. So they were closing up, cleaning up, taking the trash out. That's exactly how they came in. The cops said it was a typical modus operandi. They followed the guy right back in the door. I was on the main showroom, had a drink and a cigarette, and I was talking to one of the waitresses. The bartender was dragging the trash in and out. And off of the main room, there was a curtain that led to a hallway that led to the back door and the kitchen and the offices. So I had my back to that curtain. I was talking to the waitress, and the bartender came in to get another load of trash, and he stopped to join the conversation for a few seconds. And as I was talking to them, all of a sudden they both looked over my left shoulder and, you know, their faces were like, somebody's coming. And I thought it was somebody that I knew was going to come up behind me and do something like, you know, goofy, stupid little joke. So I turned to look and I got about halfway in my turn and about 10 inches from my face was a sawed-off shotgun. And holding the sawed-off shotgun was a guy in a ski mask, a big baggy coat, a backpack, gloves. He was completely covered. I didn't even focus on the guy, because when you have a gun pointed at you, I'm here to tell you, you focus in on the gun. I mean, I looked right at the barrel, and I remember the thought going through my head of, what a crappy job whoever sawed that sawed-off shotgun did. I mean, it was really uneven and all jagged, you know, like he was drunk when he cut the thing. So he put his finger up to his nose and he said, all right, everybody shut up. Is there anybody else up front with you yet? And we said, no. He said, all right, everybody in the back. So the waitress and the bartender moved down through the curtain, and I was the last one with the guy pointing the gun at my head. And I was thinking, look, just watch where you're going, all right? Because you have the gun still pointed at my head, so I don't want you to trip over your big shoes and blow my head off because you're a goon. So we go through the curtain, and as soon as we get through the curtain, there's another guy dressed the same way. Pointing a 9mm at my head. So now I have a sawed-off shotgun on one side of my head and a 9mm at the other side of my head. I look beyond the guy and the other four people that were there. The manager, two of the waitresses, and the bartender already face down on the kitchen floor. So they take me in and make me lay down on the kitchen floor. Now one of the guys takes the manager into the office. And you can hear them from out there. And we're laying face down on the floor, and you can hear them arguing because the guy is like, open the safe. And the other guy's like, I can't. I don't have the combination. Open the safe. I can't. I'm over the safe. I can't. So you hear a couple of cracks. He's in there smacking them around. And obviously, he must have believed that he couldn't open the safe by himself. Now, the other guy is walking up and down our legs with the sawed-off shotgun, making sure none of us do anything screwy. So he brings the manager back out and lays him on the floor. And then he tells everybody to put their arms behind their back. And now's when I really started to, like, panic and get scared inside. Because this is when you hear about, you know, people they find tied up and they shoot them anyway. So you start to think, like, all right, what am I going to do? What am I going to do? Should I make a run for it? All right, we're in the kitchen of this place. Hey, there's some knives on the wall. Maybe I should try for one of those knives. The other thought that I had is the whole world is going on outside. People are coming and going, they're going home drunk, they're going to get some greasy food, and we're in here, and our lives are on the balance. So I started thinking, all right, God, if I hear a shot and it's not my head that gets shot first. I'm just getting up. I'm gonna make a break for it. I'd rather do that than just lay here and get shot in the back of the head. Now, God, if it's my head that gets shot first, can you please make it not hurt? Because that's what everybody always says, you know, oh, we never knew what hit him. Well, how does anybody know? I mean, maybe it's the most excruciating 5 seconds of pain known to any human being anywhere. So they tied everybody up and they used those plastic draw strips that the cops use. I mean, you can't break one of those things. And they put 2 on everybody, except for me. They didn't put any on me. Why? I have no idea. Then they headed for the door and they said, look, if anybody comes out of this door in the next 50 seconds, they're gonna buy a couple. I guess that was their little gangster terminology for, you know, you're gonna get shot. So they closed the door, and the bartender was closest to the door, and he could see under the crack, you know, their feet moving around out there, where they were probably obviously taking off the ski masks and the coats and the gloves and the guns, putting them in the backpack so they could walk out and look like nothing was up. So a minute went by, and the bartender said, hey, I think they're gone. So we all kind of whispered, well, what do you want to do? Well, get up. So since I wasn't tied up, I helped everybody up, got a big kitchen knife and cut the plastic strips off, which were a... We called the cops. Cops came, separated all of us, you know, get all our stories straight, just in case it was some kind of inside job, you know. Meanwhile, the manager called the owner of the place who was up at his cabin in the mountains and told him what had happened. So he spoke to everybody one at a time, and I was the last one being interrogated, I guess you would call it, questioned. So I got on the phone with him, and he said, hey, man, I'm really sorry. You know, if there's anything I can do. And I said, well, there is, because as soon as I hang up, we are going to get so drunk on your booze. And he laughed, and he said, help yourself. And that's what we did. We took a case of Corona, a bottle of Jack, a bottle of Stoli. We stopped at a 7-Eleven. We got 7 packs of cigarettes. And we went to one of the waitresses' houses. And for the next 5 hours, all we did was drink ourselves into oblivion, smoke like we wanted to die of cancer, and talk about what had happened. Everybody going, oh, man, you know what I was thinking then? Oh, I can't believe I was thinking that. Oh, I was thinking that, too. And it was really cathartic because, like, I went home and the next day woke up and did laundry and didn't really think a lot about it. So I think going and getting drunk and talking about it just kind of brought it to the surface and got it out of my system. But the one thing that I took away from that experience and I want to pass on is do whatever you want to do, man. You know? Because when I was laying there on that floor with the other 4 people, in that moment, if you were a vegetarian or if you worked out 10 hours a day every day, or you went to church or you didn't go to church, or you ate red meat or you didn't eat red meat, or you killed animals or you clubbed baby seals, it didn't matter. We would have all been dead. So do whatever you want to do. If you don't want to go to the gym today, don't go. You want to eat a Big Mac, go eat one. Have 2 of the things, because you just never know. You just never know.